Welcome to the second session of teleconference. In our previous session, we discussed care during pregnancy. We also discussed some component of anemia during pregnancy. We will continue in this session the discussion on anemia during pregnancy. We will also take up two more topics, that is heart disease in pregnancy, and if time permits, we will take jaundice in pregnancy. To discuss these topics, we have the same group of experts, Dr. Kamala Ganesh to my left, Dr. Ashok to her left, and Dr. Asmita in the extreme left. Before I go to the topic proper, I want to inform the students that in the next month, that in the month of May, we will not have any teleconference for PGDMC's program. However, those who are interested, they can attend a teleconference on obstetrician gynae, which will be conducted by Federation of Obstetrician and Gynecology on May 6th, that is the first Sunday. But for our program, we will have our next teleconference in the month of June, that is on the third Sunday, in which we will discuss pediatrics, that is the second part of the IMNCI, which will deal with the older child. Now, in this session, we will take up the first topic, that is anemia during pregnancy. So, I will request Dr. Asmita to tell us that what is the management of anemia during pregnancy. We have already discussed the etiology and the other causes, but now let us see how you can manage anemia case at the periphery. Dr. Asmita, please.
Now we are going to discuss the management mainly confining to the nutritional anemias, in which the most important cause is a deficiency of iron. So the management principles will be a supplementation of iron. In very severe cases, they may need blood transfusion, and then we need to give a supportive therapy in form of, if patient has an associated worm infestation which needs to be treated by drugs. If patient has urinary tract infections or other associated problem, treatment of that. And of course, being a nutritional deficiency, most important component will be the information regarding nutrition and the prescription of a balanced diet for an individual patient. Now, the most important component is an iron therapy. The iron therapy can be given by two ways. It can be either an oral iron or it can be a parenteral iron. And the first and foremost, or the first line of therapy, is a oral iron therapy in the patients. The elemental iron which is available in the market as various preparations or is available in Government of India supply as a 60 milligram elemental iron and a folic acid of 500 micrograms. This has to be started in the dose of one tablet OD and then gradually increased to up to 1 to 3 tablets per day as per as the patient's tolerance. Oral iron therapy is generally associated with the side effects like nausea and vomiting. So the tolerance is very important, and these side effects are usually dose related. So if we give the excessive dosage of a drug and patient does not tolerate, she will not take it. So we have to be careful that start with a lower dose and increase it according to the patient's tolerance. The important point that we should remember when we start an oral iron therapy, that the increase in hemoglobin level starts after 2 to 3 weeks. So that immediately after starting an oral iron therapy, there may not be any change in hemoglobin percentage, but patient may slightly feel symptomatically better. And once after 3 weeks, once an initial rise starts, the hemoglobin will increase at the rate of 0.5 to 0.7 grams per week. So we must have an adequate time when we diagnose anemia during pregnancy so that we can start an oral iron therapy. If patient has a mild to moderate anemia which is diagnosed before 32 weeks of gestation, then only we can start the patient on an oral iron therapy and the hemoglobin rise will be gradual.
May I interrupt here, Asmita? Actually, many of you might wonder that 100 tablets are prescribed during pregnancy as a prophylactic measure. Now, you must know why that 100 tablets have been prescribed. It's prescribed freely by the Government of India. So, we as obstetricians usually prescribe from the third month, starting from the third month after the nausea and vomiting had stopped. And we continue it throughout the pregnancy and as well as during the puerperium for 3 months. And the contention is many women are even though their hemoglobin may be high, their bone stores in the bone marrow may be less. So that to replace those iron stores, it will take care of that. So oral iron is given. But government cannot supply such a huge amount to all the women. So they had said that women who are not anemic, you give them the requirement of iron during pregnancy. That is, as Asmita had already said, 1 gram of iron is required. So 100 milligram tablet is actually the government of India is supplying. 100 milligram iron, elemental iron with 0.5 or 500 microgram of folate, yes, each tablet contains. For 100 tablets makes it 1000 milligram. That is that requirement for the pregnancy. That is why the 100 tablets are prescribed. When they are anemic, you need to prescribe them more, 2 to 3 tablets per day. And of course, the other things goes along with that. So I wanted to clarify that point.
So there is a difference between the prophylaxis, iron prophylaxis during pregnancy, which is given to fulfill the basic increased requirements during pregnancy, and the iron therapy which we give for the treatment of an anemia. And with an iron therapy, whichever route we use, we are going to need at least 2 to 3 weeks before we can have a clinically recognizable rise in a hemoglobin percentage. So we must have a time of at least 4 weeks before patient goes for a delivery to increase an hemoglobin estimate, increase in the hemoglobin percentage by a significant amount. If patient is very closer to the term, our iron therapy is not going to be useful in treating her anemia.
Dr. Ashok, would you like to add that
regarding the iron therapy? Regarding the oral iron therapy, actually, this ferrous sulfate or the formulation basically, usually the ferrous sulfate is being given and this is there in the government of India, but now we have different other formulation. The idea of giving different formulation is that to minimize the side effects. And by minimizing the side effects means that the compliance will be better. Like nausea, vomiting, constipation or diarrhea will not be there with the patient. So patient will feel happy to take it and patient will show interest in the tablet also. So we have different formulation, like we have carbonyl iron or we have some other form of iron. So idea is to make it a pleasant intake of iron so that patient takes it and we tackle this problem for anemia.
Which formulations are better for side effects are less, the tolerance is better?
See, what I will say that actually we have different formulation in the market, but more or less all serves the same purpose, and it is basically the mindset and the adjustment of the patient. Whatever formulation patient is adjusted to or patient feel comfortable, that is best for her.
See, I will add to what Ashok had said. Counseling is very, very important. When you give iron therapy to a patient, you should give her certain instructions and make her feel that she is welcome to come back to you if she cannot tolerate iron. See, you should tell her that this preparation may suit you, may not suit you. But if it doesn't suit you, don't sit at home. Come back and tell me. I can give you an alternate prescription for you. But unless you tell me, I will not be able to know that. So you should come back to me. So that counseling part is very, very important. And another thing that is important is, many a time that Asmita said that the hemoglobin rise starts after 2 to 3 weeks. And that it increases at the rate of 0.7, 0.8 grams per week. It is rapid. So every time the patient comes, you must tell her that you must ensure that her hemoglobin is rising. If it doesn't rise, one has to find out the reason why it is not rising and take remedial measures. Otherwise, we do see very often people are coming for antenatal checkups till the end and we neglect them, saying that, oh, I advised iron, she didn't take it. That is no reason that we can accept that her hemoglobin hasn't come up. And they have a lot of morbidities during labor and after delivery. So this should not happen. When she has come to us, we have to take care of her. So we must ensure that her hemoglobin should increase. And if it is not increasing due to any other problem, give her parenteral iron. Do something. So it is our duty as healthcare providers to ensure that once we have prescribed iron to an anemic patient, the anemia is improving in subsequent visits, and we have to ensure, make sure to every with every patient that your hemoglobin, you have to tell her in the beginning, you it will rise, you must come and tell me your hemoglobin, then they will tell you. So otherwise they also do not, in busy hospitals especially, or if there is a very busy OPD, people are neglected and they don't come and tell you everything. And this is something which is very, very important for the patient as well as for the healthcare provider to ensure that her hemoglobin is increasing.
See, basically we have to see the tolerance of the iron therapy as well as like we have to ensure on follow-up that whether she is taking or iron or not, because sometimes they may not be able to tell you whether they are taking iron or not. So simple is you ask about the color of the stool. And if they say it is black, then it justifies that she is taking iron tablets. Then we can do early blood test also to see whether Hb is rising, or reticulocyte count, which is the earliest to rise. That will tell whether she is taking iron therapy regularly or not. But besides this, the important thing is that...
No, I would suggest that next visit she comes.
Yeah, that is...
She should come with the hemoglobin and patient should know whether her hemoglobin had increased or not.
No, that is what I am saying, that sometime hemoglobin may not, hemoglobin rise may not be visible in the test because lab variation may be there, they may not be able to tell, detect minor differences. But reticulocyte is the another objective parameter which will tell us whether she is taking iron regularly and whether it is giving some improvement to that patient or not. The other thing which I want to highlight here is that if she is taking iron, she is tolerating iron, still her parameters fails to demonstrate the rise as expected, then we have to be very careful. We have to review our diagnosis, probably we are wrong, or she might be suffering from some other hemoglobinopathies or some other disorder which we have to take care. Sometimes what happens that they are taking iron, or they take sometimes irregular iron, or we fail to identify the rise in the hemoglobin and we switch over to the other form of iron therapy, like parenteral iron therapy. But still the situation is same because we are dealing with some other problem in which maybe iron is not required. So at this junction, we have to review our diagnosis. So counseling, iron tolerance and the follow-up about the rise in the hemoglobin or the benefit of the therapy. Another important benefit the patient will tell that her symptoms will improve. She will feel better from inside, that she has increased her appetite and she is feeling much better. There will be feeling of general well-being. So that way one can assess she is improving with the iron therapy or not.
I think here this intake, as you are pointing out, like taking tea and other things, those combinations, perhaps we have to slightly highlight so that how the iron absorption is improved and how it is hampered. Those points may be...
No, the instructions are very important, that one thing is calcium and iron should not be taken together. Because if you advise calcium and iron, you have to ensure that the iron is taken at one time and the calcium at other time. If you prescribe them together and they take it together, then the iron is not absorbed. And the second thing is, they have to, for increase in iron absorption, they should take some vitamin C, so they can take with the diet the material or the nutrients containing diet. Like they can have some salads with nimbu on it, amla on it. All those things will help in absorption. And then also for better absorption, tea and coffee should not be consumed half an hour to 1 hour before and after. So if they take it, and lot of green leafy vegetables are taken, so all these will take care that the maximum iron absorption occurs. Yeah.
Maybe we can now switch over to the parenteral iron therapy. Can you highlight those issues?
Parenteral iron therapy is basically indicated when the patient is a suitable candidate for an iron therapy, but she cannot tolerate oral iron, or she has a problem, as Dr. Ashok said, like she is taking it regularly, but there is a malabsorption or there is some other associated problem because of which the iron that is being taken orally is not being utilized. or in some situation, in spite of your appropriate counseling and all instructions to the patient, patient is not following your instructions or she is not compliant with the therapy, as we can elicit it from the history. In those situations, we may need to hospitalize the patient and give her a parenteral iron so that we can ensure an adequate intake of iron to her. Again, as far as the parenteral iron is concerned, we have various preparations available in market, and depending on the choice of a route for which we are going to give a parenteral iron, which can be either intramuscular or intravenous, we will prefer to use the iron therapy, iron preparation. The when we give a parenteral iron, we cannot just randomly give her 10 or 15 or 20 injections. We need to calculate the iron requirement of an individual patient. And we calculate this iron deficit by calculating the hemoglobin deficit, multiplying it by the weight of the patient in pounds and multiplied that by 0.3. So this will be calculating the total deficit. To this we must add 500 milligram to 1 gram for the replenishments of our iron stores, and this particular dose then is to be divided into 10 or 15 or whatever injections we calculate it to be. One thing we must remember, that because we are giving iron in a parenteral route, it doesn't mean that her hemoglobin will rise faster. It takes the same amount of time either we give iron orally or parenterally to result in increase in hemoglobin. And the reason why we do not prefer a parenteral iron is because it can be sometimes associated with a very serious side effects like an anaphylactic reaction or fever, arthralgia. These injections are very painful and can cause injection abscesses. That is the reason the parenteral iron is in second line of iron therapy for an iron deficiency anemia.
Okay.
Now here I would like to add that for parental therapy, we have to take precaution. It should not be given by anybody anywhere. It should be given in a hospital setting only, and we have to have the facility for emergency care, and we have to have the facility for resuscitation immediately available before we give any parental form of iron therapy. So that one should take care. Otherwise, usually in most of the places we prefer that we give parenteral iron therapy, and it avoids and it takes care of the factor like patient compliance. So where the problem of compliance is there, there you can prefer that you can give parenteral iron.
Madam, would you like to comment? Because in periphery where resuscitation or other facilities will not be there.
Exactly.
What about the parenteral
therapy?
So that
is, no. You can test for the skin sensitivity,
yeah,
and taking all adequate precautions, give at least keep part of the iron that is required for them on a daily basis and take care of the iron needs. So they have to take all precautions. If they are not confident enough to do the skin sensitivity, they cannot take care of an anaphylactic reactions, don't give it at that level. But, you know, considering our setup in the rural areas, doctors should learn, even not the paramedical staff, at least the doctors should learn how to give injections in the periphery, not IV. I only request for IM, deep intramuscular in a zigzag way, taking all precautions that are required for a parenteral iron therapy, they should give it. Because
so,
many people will not be otherwise benefit by the parenteral iron therapy.
Madam, I think here we can highlight about the modification in the diet also.
Yes.
Okay.
And for iron tablets, we are one side we are giving the iron tablets, but diet modification will also help in the form that, you know, the gur, which is available everywhere, that is a very good source of iron. So if we can tell a pregnant lady
jaggery.
To take that thing regularly, so probably her anemia will be taken care of. Besides this, the change in the cooking method also. If they use that lohe wala kadhai to cook their vegetables, then probably also that helps. So slightly if we give these type of education also.
I will add something more to it, which is emerging. It has not yet been prevalent and many people may not know it. These fluorides containing things, that is what we call as black salt or rock salt that contains fluoride, and the excess of fluoride, whoever is taking it, it prevents the iron absorption and can cause anemia. Now, there is nothing extra to it. Only thing is you have to not take it. So this is something which anybody can advise. So if anybody is taking extra kala namak, I understand they put it in salads, they put it in fruit salads, raitas and all that. If so, that can be avoided, wherever it is prevalent in use,
that kala namak should be avoided.
Should be avoided.
Okay.
This is something new. You will not find it in the books or in the
So the fluoride content is against iron absorption.
Iron absorption.
Okay.
So we have to take care of the diet modification or some modification in our cooking method, which will also help in preventing or taking care of this problem.
And now I think we can take up the intrapartum and postpartum management of anemia.
Before going on to the intrapartum management, I like to tell you just a word about a blood transfusion. It is not something which is available at all the facilities, but in the patients with anemia who are at risk of a high mortality, blood transfusion plays a very, very important role, that it can really save a life of a woman if it is given in time. So there are certain situations where the blood transfusion is probably the only treatment which is going to help the patient. So the indications for blood transfusion during pregnancy include, if the patient is before 36 weeks of a gestation, it means that you still have a time for correction of an anemia with oral iron. But if our anemia is very severe, like hemoglobin less than 5 g/cent, we must make it at least moderate and bring it to 6 and 7, and then start her on an oral iron therapy. Or if anemia is presenting with the complications like a congestive cardiac failure, the blood transfusion can be life-saving. Then in a group of patients who are near term, that they can go into labor anytime or they can deliver anytime, your oral iron will not be of much help to the patient. And so in that situation, we must correct the anemia with a blood transfusion. So beyond 36 weeks, if hemoglobin is less than 6 g/cent, we must give blood transfusion. And if hemoglobin is between 6 to 8 g, but patient is having some risk factor, like she may require a cesarean section, or she has an antepartum hemorrhage, or she is a twins and likely to go for a postpartum hemorrhage, then we must consider a blood transfusion. So it's very important that blood transfusion is judiciously used to avoid the death of the mother and the morbidity. With blood transfusion, the hemoglobin rise is seen within 24 hours, but the oxygen carrying capacity immediately increases, so that helps the patient and avoids the mortality. Then the next we move to the intrapartum management. Our objective of an treatment of an anemia is that our patient must reach the labor with an corrected anemia and should not be at least severely anemic. Mild anemia is all right, but it should not be moderate or a severe anemia when patient is in labor. By and large, there are not much difference in the obstetric management or the management of a labor in anemic patients. We expect or await the spontaneous labor. The only precaution that we should take, depending on the severity of anemia, that the appropriate blood should be arranged for the patient. The aim should be for a patient should deliver vaginally. We should avoid fluid overload, because during pregnancy there is already hyperdynamic circulation, anemia is aggravating that pathology. So the fluid that is given during labor should be restricted. We must chart the partogram very carefully, because in these patients we do not want them to go into prolonged labor and have other complications. The third active management of third stage of labor is very, very important to reduce the blood loss during third stage, and oxytocin 5 units intramuscular should be given at the birth of the anterior shoulder, and the placenta should be delivered by the controlled cord section. The cesarean section is not indicated per se for anemia and should be restricted only for the obstetric indications and should be avoided as far as possible in an anemic patients, because it will add on to the increased blood loss during the delivery.
Okay, can you tell the postpartum management also?
Okay, the postpartum management is similar as in any other patient. The only precautions that we need to take, that these are the patients who are more prone for infections like a puerperal sepsis. So any earlier sign and symptom like a fever or a foul smelling discharge should be taken care of in time. The iron therapy which we have initiated during pregnancy has to be continued throughout the postpartum period till the patient is breastfeeding, and even beyond that. And breastfeeding, as in any other pregnancy, has to be initiated in these patients.
No, will you like to add anything in the interpretum?
Yeah.
Otherwise, we can go to the prevention, how we can prevent anemia. Those components we can cover now.
Okay, prevention of an anemia is a very, very important thing. The prophylactic iron therapy, as it is recommended by Government of India program, is that elemental iron 60 to 100 milligram throughout the pregnancy. It contains iron as well as folic acid, and minimum 100 days. The Dr. Ganesh has already told you what is the logic behind this 100 days prescription. Again, the point that we have already discussed is the significance of a balanced diet, iron rich food like jaggery, and adequate protein intake so that the hemoglobin synthesis goes on normally during the pregnancy. Then early treatment of problems like worm infestation, malaria, especially in endemic areas, is very, very important. And the most important component of prevention of an anemia is the planning of a subsequent pregnancy. The patient who is already anemic, delivers, and is having again blood loss is likely to have depletion of her iron stores and more at risk of increased anemia in subsequent pregnancy. So we must advise them appropriate contraception so that the pregnancies are spaced and patient has enough time in between to recover from the anemia and get her stores, iron stores replenished appropriately. So a word about the contraception in patients after delivery. We generally prefer oral contraceptive pills after patient's breastfeeding is stopped, that is around 4 to 6 months. Because oral pills generally interfere with the quality and the quantity of breast milk, so are not recommended during lactation. And if appropriately followed, lactational amenorrhea method can be good enough. Oral pills have an advantage that they reduce the blood loss during menstruation, so the anemia can be corrected. Barrier methods are also good provided patient uses it properly, but the failure rates can be a limitation. Intrauterine contraceptive devices should generally be avoided in a patient with anemia for two reasons. Number one, they can have are associated with increased blood loss, especially in initial 3 to 6 months, which can aggravate the anemia. And they also increase the risk of an infection because all the anemic women are slightly higher risk of an infection. Then, of course, sterilization is a choice after correction of an anemia if the family is complete.
Okay, I think we have now come to the end of the topic, that is anemia in pregnancy.
Here, I just want to add one more thing, is that for sterilization, the hemoglobin level, what we require as given in the guidelines also, that for anesthesia purposes also, hemoglobin level should be more than 8 only, and that is sufficient for the sterilization procedure. So it is not necessary that we should attempt to rise the hemoglobin by 10 or 11.
By then they will become pregnant.
Yes. Yeah. So rather we should not deny the opportunity to do sterilization in these women if they have completed, because by doing sterilization only, we will stop the process of this pregnancy, and thereby her general condition or hemoglobin
anemia will improve
on its own. So, we should just make effort that her hemoglobin is more than 8, and then we can go for sterilization.
And another point that we must consider, that sterilization doesn't always mean a female sterilization. If the mother is anemic, she is at a high risk of an anesthesia, we can always counsel and consider a husband's vasectomy as a method of a sterilization in the particular couple.
Okay, I think now before we switch over to other topic, I will request the students who are attending this teleconference, please start asking the questions so that we will modify our questions or session accordingly. You can fax the questions or you can ask directly over the telephone. Now our next topic will be heart disease during pregnancy. You have already received the material, and I hope some of you have already started reading, and it must have been covered in your spell training also. Before going to the details of the heart disease, now I'll ask Dr. Kamala Ganesh. Can you please tell us what are the types of lesion, heart lesions that we come across during heart disease in pregnancy?
See, the most common heart lesions we see is due to rheumatic heart disease, mitral stenosis, and of course with the increasing cardiac surgery for congenital abnormalities, we are seeing more and more patients of congenital heart disease who have already had surgery, just like for patent ductus arteriosus, septal defects. So they are being seen now. So the second is this, and the third, of course, the category who can have heart problem due to thyrotoxicosis, hypertensive disorders, cardiomyopathies, ischemic heart disease and all. So these are the three category, that is rheumatic heart disease causing valvular disease, congenital problems, and of course the third will be this thing. And of course one must remember that there are certain conditions, heart conditions, which can cause, where the woman should not become pregnant at all, because it is contraindicated. Pregnancy is contraindicated in such lesions. So all those can be discussed.
Dr. Ashok, can you tell us the functional classification? See, for the heart disease, yeah, in case of pregnancy.
For just for the ease on that, how to assess the patient subjectively, we have this classification of New York Heart Association, and in this we classify in four groups. So class one will be that the woman who can carry on their activity or active life without discomfort. That means they are asymptomatic at rest. And they are asymptomatic also while doing their like normal activity. And class 2 is when they experience dyspnea or exertion or any other symptoms on ordinary physical activity. And class 3 is when they experience these symptoms even on light physical activity. And class 4 is when they are unable to carry on any physical activity and it is they are symptomatic on rest also. And on these symptoms, actually what we are looking at, the symptoms in all these classification we are looking at is the dyspnea, that is shortness of breath, then palpitation, chest pain, and fatigability, like how soon they become fatigued on their routine activity. So these are the four symptoms on which we assess these women, and then we classify. And this basically is the subjective symptoms, and usually when we classify these, our purpose is we don't want them to relate to the degree of cardiac lesion basically. So this is a functional classification only, and by this is just a simple guide that during pregnancy how they will behave.
And so, also they can change from one class to the other during pregnancy.
Yeah, depending upon the fluid load and other.
Depending on the treatment or depending on the worsening precipitating factor, their class can change from one to other.
Okay, can you also add us that what is the effect of the disease on the pregnancy and effect of pregnancy on the disease?
See, the heart disease has effect on the fetus, on the mother. So first we tell about the fetus, like what all it can cause. In any woman with the cardiac disease, basically there is a chronic hypoxia, and that leads to the problem of intrauterine growth retardation, and with that is the problem of preterm delivery and prematurity, and sometime intrauterine fetal death. So these are the main areas. Then the another is if the woman has congenital heart disease, so there are more chances that these congenital heart disease may be there in the fetus also. So they slightly increase risk of the congenital heart disease in the fetus. Then the problem with the mother. In the mother, the severe type of problem which can occur is the death of the mother during pregnancy. So beside this, the other morbidity will be in the form of endocarditis, arrhythmias, then they may have some repeated embolic events, and heart failure, and pulmonary hypertension. So these are the main complications which these women can have during pregnancy.
So now you should also highlight now that women who should not undertake a pregnancy.
Yeah. Usually we advise that the woman who condition is not stable, they are in the severe category of their problem, they should avoid pregnancy. Otherwise, we absolutely avoid pregnancy.
Yeah, there is a call from Bhopal. Yeah. Yes, from Bhopal.
Hello.
Yes, we can listen.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Sir, my question was that why can't we give the iron before 3 months of pregnancy?
Will you like to answer?
Yeah. I will answer. The question was already answered because the first 3 months, the woman experiences nausea and vomiting. So, because of that reason, they may not be able to tolerate additional iron along with the nausea vomiting. So, the iron is not advised. But if any woman can tolerate iron, there is no harm in giving iron even in first trimester. It's not contraindicated.
Yeah, so the issue is actually not a contraindication, but usually we avoid because of the tolerance problem. So it is not a teratogenic effect.
No.
That is what we want to highlight. Yeah. Yes,
think you can continue. Yes, we were continuing about the contraindication of pregnancy in a heart disease patient. So I told you about the severe heart disease patient or the patient who are unstable. Besides this, we absolutely avoid pregnancy in some of the high-risk cardiac lesion like Eisenmenger syndrome, the patient with the pulmonary hypertension or severe ischemic heart disease. And here, these are the very common problem, but there are some uncommon problem also which can be encountered. And just to complete the list, we can have dilated cardiomyopathy and dilated aortic root with severe obstructive lesion. In this situation also, we would like to avoid pregnancy.
Okay, now you can tell us that how we'll manage a case of heart disease in pregnancy.
For the management point of view, actually, we have to first of all evaluate the general condition of the patient, and we have to see that what is her status of her cardiac problem and how far she is stable, and then we have to identify whether she is having any high risk factor or not. High risk factors means whether she is having cyanosis or it is a cyanotic heart disease, pulmonary hypertension, or she is having any previous history or previous cardiomyopathy, or she has any impaired myocardial function, or she is having poor functional class, maybe class 3 or class 4, and or she has previous history of heart failure or any infection. So these if factors are present, the patient becomes very high risk. So after assessing this, obviously during pregnancy we have to do the repeated frequent antenatal checkups, and we have to pick up any abnormal condition in these, any precipitating factor or high risk factor if she has. Then for the labor,
I would add to that, Dr. Ashok, that we should have a cardiologist assisting us in managing these patients.
No,
so wherever possible, since we ourselves said that they can go from one class to the other class, the management together with the cardiologist is the best option for the patient. And wherever the facilities are not available, they should be referred to a facility where a combined management of the patient is the best.
Yes.
So we should try to achieve that.
So obviously for medical disorder, because these are specialized problems which can be there, so one has to have multidisciplinary approach so that we give maximum benefit to the patient. So in antenatal period, only thing we have to take care is that she should not deteriorate from her class, and if she has any high risk factor, we should take care of that high risk factor, and we should have frequent antenatal visits. So these are the important highlight of the antenatal examination. Then we have the labor. In labor, we have to be very careful, and we have to monitor the patient. Obviously, this has to be in a, it is better if she delivers in a tertiary center, and where all the facilities are available. And there, for the first stage of labor, again, we have to keep a watch on the main thing is the heart failure. So that is the main factor which we have to take care. And for the second stage also, because what happens that uterine contractions and painful stimuli of labor, they basically increases the cardiac output, and which may be detrimental to the health of the mother in this setting. So we have to avoid this. So that is why we have to be very careful, and sometimes we give analgesia also in labor to these patients, or we have to restrict their fluid intake or fluid by intravenous route. If we have to augment the labor or we have to induce the labor, we give concentrated oxytocin, means we give more oxytocin, we put more oxytocin in less volume of normal saline or Ringer lactate, and we infuse slowly. So that we have to take care, and obviously we have to give them antibiotic. There are two thoughts on that. One is you give prophylaxis for subacute bacterial endocarditis. That means before your patient goes into labor, you start the antibiotic like ampicillin, gentamicin or metrogyl in combination, and you repeat it 8 hourly. The other thought is that once the patient goes into labor, you give a high dose of bolus antibiotic like ampicillin or amoxicillin with the gentamicin, and then you followed it for 5 to 7 days. So it depends on the protocol which is being followed at each center, and accordingly you take care. Basically purpose is that you avoid the infection, and you have to follow all the aseptic precaution. In the second stage of the labor, we have to take care about the that she should not exert too much in the second stage. We have to sometime cut short the second stage depending on the facilities available, either by forceps or by ventuse application. And for the third stage of the labor, again we have to be very careful, and we have to do the active management of the third stage of the labor. We have to avoid postpartum hemorrhage. We have, because any amount of blood loss or maybe again detrimental to these patients, because they may not tolerate a small amount of blood loss. So the definition of postpartum hemorrhage, which is there about like 500 ml of blood loss should be there in normal pregnancy, that does not hold true in these patients. Here we have to limit the blood loss, and for that we have to do the active management of the third stage of the labor.
Okay, there is one more call. Yes.
Hello.
Please quickly ask your question.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Hello, I'm Dr. Eva Bhopal se bol raha hu.
Yes.
Sir, if the PVT is positive in the first trimester of the pregnancy, then the anti-malarial drug should be given or not?
Okay, quickly, can you reply? We have only 1 minute left. Yeah.
See, whenever a woman is suffering from a problem, like if the woman has got suffering from active malaria, if you don't treat, she is going to abort. So you have to take the risk, but you can give the risk, the drug which is the safest out of whatever is available. So you can treat with chloroquine during the first trimester, there is no problem. But if you don't treat her anyway, she, the fever itself or the parasite itself will ensure that she aborts. So we want to prevent that, so you can give her chloroquine, no problem, if she is actively suffering from malaria.
I think chloroquine is not contraindicated in the first trimester of pregnancy. Yes. So it can be very well given, because any rate you have to see that the mother's health is more important in that situation.
Yes, see, there are situations where you have to treat. Just because a mother is pregnant and has tuberculosis, you cannot deny her the treatment of tuberculosis. Yes. You have to treat her tuberculosis. That way, if she is suffering from malaria, the malaria has got to be treated.
Yes. I think I just summarized what Dr. Ashok was telling. Basically, heart disease with pregnancy, we have to see that during labor, we have to decrease the fluid intake and we have to decrease the pain. And also, we have to cut short the second stage and the third stage of labor, so that the patient doesn't deteriorate. And we have to see that there is no PPH also. We will continue the discussion in our next session. We will have a 15-minute break now. We will be back again at 3:30.